Well, I'm so glad to be here today, and thank you for this opportunity. We're going to start out just by telling you a little bit about what you told us, what we learned from you. We did a research study to really look at what men really say about intimacy after prostate cancer. And it has been an incredible journey. I've been all over the country. I've spoken to a lot of US2 groups. I've been in Walnut Creek, California. I've been in Hilo, Hawaii. I've been down in Monica, Illinois. I've been all over Chicagoland. And it's been a pleasure to meet many of you and be a part of your groups. And I really appreciate the sharing that people did and the willingness to participate in our study. And we just want to share a couple of the quotes that we learned from patients, because I think the words are really powerful, and I think the things that men and their partners say are very, very powerful. So we're going to share a little bit of that with you today, and then we'll get into actually our 50 Shades of Love. And we've put a lot of things in front of you, but you're going to have all day after we're finished. You'll have all evening to look through all that stuff, so you can look through it later. But there's all kinds of fun things that we gave you, including my book. So I would like to say a couple things. The book was made possible by William D. and Pamela Huddle Ross, who are two people who said, prostate cancer and sex need a face and a name, and we're not afraid to put our face and name out there. And so they gave money to the foundation, to the research that I do, that created that book. That book would not be sitting in front of you for free. It costs $20 on Amazon, but it's sitting in front of you for free thanks to Bill and Pam Ross, because they said, you know what, there's nothing to be ashamed of. We need to talk about these things, and people really need help. Because we live in this crazy culture where sex is everywhere. It's on the billboards. It's everywhere you look. And isn't this strange here? We filled you up with food, and then what do we talk about after lunch? God and sex. Here we are. You know what? I think it's not a bad thing. It ought to keep you awake. But the bottom line is, sex is everywhere. If you think, I don't want to know about sex, I don't want to think about sex, I don't want anything to do with sex, you're in big trouble in our culture, right? But when you have a sexual problem, the amazing thing is, nobody's talking. Nobody's talking. Well, I'm talking, that's for sure. And Dr. Sizemore's talking, that's for sure. But a lot of times people aren't talking. They're embarrassed. It's stigmatized. It's so difficult to talk about these things. But what we find is if you don't talk about them, it becomes problematic. Sometimes we're going to talk a lot about communication, and our communication on sex is complicated. So first we want to introduce you to a little bit about what we did with our study. You know that prostate cancer is the most common non-skin cancer in men. You certainly know that. And most men will survive prostate cancer. Prostate cancer is very survivable. We talk about cure all the time with prostate cancer. But the sexual side effects are the number one long-term side effects. Not everybody is greatly impacted by them, but some people certainly are dramatically impacted by those. And you'll hear from some of the things that some of the men said, that some people are very much affected and some people are not so much. So there really weren't any studies looking specifically at the lived experience. What do men and their partners say about what it's like in terms of sex and intimacy after prostate cancer treatment? So we did a qualitative study. This is a lot of fancy stuff that tells you we asked a couple descriptive questions, we gave some questionnaires out, and then we asked these open-ended questions. We said, describe your journey with sexual dysfunction after prostate cancer. That's it. Tell us about it. Tell us your story. And then we would prompt them later. We'd say, is there anything else from your experience that you think would be helpful for other men and their partners, or for providers who take care of people with prostate cancer to know and understand about your experience with sexual issues after prostate cancer? And then at the end, we'd say, is there anything else that you want to share? And men were very forthright, and so were their partners. So we did very complicated analysis, and I don't want to go into great detail to make sure that we accurately captured what people said. And if you want to know more about that, I can talk more about it later. But I don't want to spend a lot of time on it because it's really a lot of science stuff. But if you're interested, I'm happy to share any of that with you. We are working on this first publication that we will be finalizing and submitting for peer-reviewed publication in journals. And we will also be publishing the results in the US2 Hot Sheets as well. But we had 27 men and 8 partners that participated in the study. Most of the men were Caucasian, but we did have about 15% African-American men, and then a few Asian men as well. And then the education level was pretty high in our group. They mostly came from our clinic at North Shore, or else they came from US2 groups around the country. I have spoken all over the country, New York. Actually, we caught both coasts. We actually had participants from the West Coast and participants from the East Coast and lots of participants from Chicago as well. So they were pretty well educated. Most of them have had their prostate surgically removed. Some of them had radiation, as you can see, and they were supposed to be 1 to 5 years after their treatment, and the average time for the patients was about 23 months, give or take about 12 months. The majority of the men did not report erectile dysfunction before they had their treatment, 74%, but the majority of the men were really struggling with erectile dysfunction after their treatment. So what did we find out? Well, we found out a couple really important themes that came out of it. Men talked over and over about the importance of comprehensive information that they didn't know, they didn't understand, they didn't fully comprehend, especially the sexual ramifications of the treatments. And the men who were happy, the interesting thing was, the men who were really happy with their care said they were well prepared in terms of sexual side effects, that they'd been told a lot of information and they'd gotten good information about it. So over and over we heard about the importance of education and comprehensive information. We're going to share with you two of the quotes, one from a patient and one from a partner. So first, let's hear what one of the patients said. It was so hard to pick which quote. They were all so good. But I wanted to be succinct, so let's start with one from a patient.
I think everybody, all the medical staff, starting with nursing and support staff and the doctors themselves, they really need to inform the patient with what's going to happen after the surgery with complications and side effects, and on the surgical end and the physical end, but also then that the effects from the surgery should be talked about from the get-go so that patients are not surprised, that they know what's going to be heading their way. And they should be given the full information. If they get better results, they'll be ecstatic. The people who will struggle and not be so fortunate, they will at least know ahead of time that this is a normal consequence, because I used to think I'm screwed, and I wasn't. Just most men have this, and it's kept under the rug, and that's awful. The medical community has to do a better job. That's my opinion. And I'm very, very emotionally upset about it, because if I would have known, I think I would have been in a better place through the first year and following that first year if I knew.
Here's a quote from a partner. I think we didn't have enough information in the beginning. We had it afterwards, so we didn't know what we were getting into. All we knew was that I wanted him to live and I just wanted the cancer out. And I think that, meaning more information and support, that kind of thing would get him ready, or it could make him not want to get the surgery. I don't know, but we did this with closed eyes, and that hurt him a lot, I bet. So men really talked about how important comprehensive information was. And honestly, it was so interesting. Those that were happy with their care said they really got good upfront information about sexual side effects, and those who were unhappy felt they were not well prepared for sexual incontinence side effects, that it had been brushed over. A lot of the guys we talked to were very frustrated with their sexual dysfunction. They found it extremely frustrating, and some of them were very upset about it. Some of the guys who did well, though, said, you know, they told me from the start it was going to be like this, so I felt well prepared, and it was like this, and these are the things that I dealt with. Then we were really taken by the psychological ramifications of sexual dysfunction. These men talked candidly about depression, suicide, all kinds of things after their prostate cancer treatment that they felt had not been addressed. And we were really, we thought it was really insightful, some of the things that they had to say about it. And I'd love to share more of the things that they'd have to say. We're going to share a few more quotes, but I can't quite get it all in this amount of time. Also, we'll talk a bit about the importance of support and understanding. But first, let's do a couple more quotes about the impact, about the frustration of these men. And here's two quotes from two different men.
Because this absolutely sucks. It's been very, very difficult for my wife and I. I feel a great amount of guilt for her even being with me, a great amount of guilt. But why did I even propose to her and subject her to this, what I consider an unfulfilling marriage? How else has it changed? I don't know. I feel like in every single conceivable way, the way that I look at the rest of my life, the way that I look at everything.
This patient was devastated by what he'd been through. Now, everybody doesn't feel this way, but that's how he felt. Here's another patient said, the first 7 months were really terrifying for me, emotionally and physically and mentally. They're all intertwined. You can't perform for yourself physically if you've got fear in the back of your mind inhibiting you all the time. You're trying to perform and achieve a certain result for your sex life. Now, not everybody was completely unhappy with everything. That's for sure. Men also talked about being really grateful to be cancer-free. So it wasn't all negative at all. We did hear a lot of positive things too. So I'd like to share some of those quotes with you about how men felt really grateful for being cancer-free.
We're alive, okay? I was Gleason 7. My statistical life expectancy would be about 12 years. You know, that's average. Could be less, could be more, if I did not get treatment. And my mentality, and still is, I got it out of my body. I don't want to be messing with the cancer for the rest of my life.
Another man said, we made the decision to have it removed, both of us. And it was, you know, you got three options, and that was it. And it was a simple option for me. I didn't want to die, which sometimes you could die with prostate cancer. Another man said,
and if there were more doctors like that, if doctors could have the time, and I realize their schedules don't allow them the time, but that's a conflict right there, is the patient load per doctor is something that really needs to be addressed so that doctors do have more time to spend that kind of quality effort with every patient.
By the way, that was a patient who had his provider he was very happy with because he'd spent a lot of time, literally spent an hour and a half with that patient and partner after he'd seen another provider he was unhappy with. So we really hear some powerful statements from patients, and they were happy to be cancer-free, but they were frustrated with the sexual problems that they were having. We're going to talk today a lot about the importance of intimacy in a relationship, intimacy. And we'll talk about what intimacy is in the next part of the talk as well. And then prostate cancer treatment provider satisfaction. Satisfaction with the treatment, dissatisfaction with certain aspects of the treatment. And there's lots of things to share with that. But the last quotes we want to share with you, and then we'll move into the body of this talk, are about the importance of support and understanding from others, because that's why you're here today. And a lot of people spoke very highly of the work Us2 does. So we'll share a couple of the quotes. This is the first quote is from a partner. I think it's a really important quote for you to hear and for Us2 to hear, because some Us2 groups that we found have partner groups, some don't. And this is what one of the partners said about her experience.
I wish there would be more, why are there not women in these meetings? And I wonder, is it because we don't want to be involved or the men don't want to be embarrassed? Because I've noticed when it's more guys there, yeah, they will open up. They open up around me because they just got used to seeing me at the meeting, so they knew that I knew it was no big deal. So they'd start talking about the injections and what's going on with them sexually and blah, blah, blah. And it's fine. But I wonder if more women were at these meetings, how open would the guys really be? It seems to be like this thing where we don't really want to talk about sex anyway. We definitely don't want to talk about the fact that we can't have sex or we can't perform the way we used to. So I wish that more, and Us2 is open to anyone that wants to come, but all you see is the guys. And I'm just thinking it's got to be a little bit better to know that your woman would come or that she is there and she's holding your hand and she's okay with it. We need to talk about this. People are not talking about it. I know they're not talking about it, and I really think that's one of the reasons why treatment is not better for men, why there's limits on treatment, because men don't want to talk about this stuff the way women want to talk about it.
Another partner said, I just think for anybody, the support group's really great, and they need to come, and they just seem to have calmed him more than I could. But it's fine, and this is 1 year now, and we've been coming and haven't missed one day. Another participant male said,
and because of what those guys gave to me is the reason why I've never missed a meeting and don't intend on missing one with the hope of giving somebody else. There's always guys coming in that I can impact them with that same energy to let them know that, hey, you're not by yourself, and that if I did it and can come through it, you can do it. And so that's me, man. That's why I'm here.
Another participant said, support would be good. I think it depends on the individual, but I think support is positive, whether it is whether it would be just a men's support group or your spouse being supportive or someone else to talk to about that issue. I know when before I had surgery, I had a friend who went through it, and he was very helpful when he talked to me about it. And I think the us two part is great, is a great pick-me-up after surgery to say, these are all guys you have been who have been through it. I know what to say. This happens, then this happens, this happens. It's been great. So I think that's been a big help too. One more patient said,
this makes a big difference in my life. The information that I got here, if people could go through this before they have the stress of having it taken out, it would make a hell of a difference in my life.
Okay, so that's some of the quotes, just a few. It was really hard to pick which ones to share with you, but I think that all of these concepts, these things that we discovered from the men are really important. And actually, we will be presenting more of this in its entirety at the Lombard Us Two meeting in July. So if you're interested in learning more, there's lots more to say about it, and we're happy to share it with you. But in conclusion for this section from the study, what we found out from men was they want accurate information. They want it from the start, before they get their treatment, all the way through. They want to understand, and this is a generalization. I definitely have patients who don't want all that information and can feel a bit overwhelmed by it. But most patients, the large majority, want as much information as possible up front and then ongoing throughout the process. Intimacy is really important too. One quote, holding hands and nighttime cuddling is important. It's like it's not just about outer intercourse. It's about things like other course, which we gave you a handout on, and we're going to talk a lot more in a few minutes. Men and their partners need support. They need understanding. They feel isolated. And the partners actually talked about they felt isolated too sometimes. So they need support from each other, from significant others in their lives, and from support groups. And then also the biggest thing we learned too is you're not alone. Look at this group. You're not alone. You can turn it into action and help others and help them in their journey towards healing. And that can be important too. So I thank you, Nat Sufrin, my research assistant, for all his help collecting all those stories. There's so much more we could share with you. But we also want to share this other presentation with you, which you've come to hear, which is this one. All right, so we're going to talk about improving intimacy after prostate cancer. So Dr. Sizemore and I want to share our expertise with you, and I'm board certified in urology as an advanced practice clinical nurse specialist. So I'm certified in all of urology, but my specialty is sexual dysfunction, prostate cancer, and incontinence. And so that's why I really have worked actively. I ran a group for over 12 years at Northwestern with patients, an US2 group there, and I think that it's really important for us to talk about these subjects. So what is sex and intimacy? Let's talk a little bit about that to start with. Okay, if we went around the room and said, how would you define sex, how would you define intimacy, we'd probably have as many different definitions as people in the room. And maybe the way you defined it when you were 13 is different than the way you defined it when you were 26, when you were 56, when you were 86. But ultimately, sex is intrinsic. We're born with that sense of male or female. We're born with certain chromosomes and characteristics. That part is innate, right? But then it's culturally derived. That's for sure. We know that for a fact because people like Ed Lauman, who have studied sex all over the world, found that people start having sex at a whole different time in other cultures, and people have sex in different ways in different cultures. And so much of what we learn in our lives through religion, through our culture, our sex and what we believe about sex is culturally derived. But when we're talking about sex, we're going to talk about the acts of sex, not just penetrative sex, but all types of sex. This might be a shock to some people, and we know even presidents define sex differently sometimes, right? But sex is sex, and we're going to talk about sex now, okay? So intimacy is the process by which two people attempt to move towards more deep, meaningful communication. You heard the spirituality lecture, and you know how important meaning is. You are born with an innate drive. You will die, literally, if you don't bond to another human being. It's called failure to thrive. When you're a baby, that's your mother, that's your father. And guess what? When you're older, you might pretend like you don't, but you just as desperately need meaningful relationships in your life. It doesn't always have to be a sexual relationship, but intimacy, someone really understanding you, someone really getting you when you're going through a prostate cancer diagnosis, that somebody really knows your life story and understands you and is standing beside you, that's intimacy. And that's vitally important. And that's what people in our study said too. We've become closer. The intimacy has become deeper. Sometimes that's difficult though, because there's some hurdles to get over, because we think, but wait, I have to have an erection to have intimacy. I can't, this is going to be a disaster. What if I don't get hard? And that's a really big, what if I don't get hard? My God, talk about an erection killer, really? That's what you're thinking while you're having sex? Trust me. Guess what, people? Here's the thing. If you are getting nervous and you're thinking, how hard am I? I wonder what it's doing. Oh God, I hope it's doing something. I don't know what it's doing. That's called adrenaline. It's part of fight or flight. Fight or flight is a mechanism your body has to get away so you don't die from predators. And when you're running from a predator, this may be a shock to the men in the room, the blood's going to go to vital organs and the penis isn't one of them. I hate to tell you, but it's not. It's going to go to your brain. It's going to go to your heart. It's going to go to your muscles, because the truth is you've got to get away from a predator because your anxiety and adrenaline is rising. So as you get nervous, you're killing erections. Anxiety goes up, erection goes down. That's how it works. Trust me. So the more anxious you get and the more you think it's all about the erection, the more disastrous it's going to become. But from the time you were born, and the women in the room, maybe you don't realize this, from the day you were born, you had erections every day of your life, 4 to 6 of them, mostly while you were sleeping. That's what keeps the penis healthy, 4 to 6 erections every day of your life. And then it stops. It's not doing anything. And then sometimes people say, why are men so devastated by it? Because this thing that's been doing something my whole life is not doing something that it's done my whole life anymore. And always when I was excited, it was a barometer of how excited I was. But now it's not. I could be so excited, it's crazy, and nothing's happening. Or my wife thinks it's a barometer of how excited I am, and so now she thinks I'm not excited because it's not doing anything. All of these things are tied up in it, but if you break free of it and say, I can have a climax with or without an erection, that's why we gave you literally the pamphlet on other course, and I teach patients all the time about outer course, because an erection is not a prerequisite in any way, shape, or form to either desire or climax. You could be as hard as a bone, and if you have trouble climaxing, you're still going to have trouble climaxing. You can be as soft as can be, and you can still climax. And those men in the room who've had erectile dysfunction know that's a fact, because they're wired separately. So that's really, really important. So intimacy. So then we stop being affectionate. We stop holding the hand of our partner because we think, I don't want to put pressure on him. I don't want to make him feel bad. And he's struggling, or I'm scared because he had the surgery and maybe whatever. But guess what? That's affection and intimacy, and it's important. And the guy's going, I don't want to start something because I don't know how to finish it because my whole life we've always done this. Challenging, difficult. But intimacy is vital to human beings, and vital, a vital part of being a prostate cancer survivor. Maybe your intimacy comes from your intimate relationship with family members and friends, but also maybe that special significant other in your life. So expand your thinking about intimacy and sex. Why do people have sex after they've had children? Nobody knows, huh? Okay. Why do you think they have sex after they have children, Dr. Sizemore?
I think they like it. I think it's fun. They want to have fun.
Exactly. Yeah. They want to have fun. It is about nothing but pleasure. But now, I just see him take the Viagra and my blood pressure goes up to here. Or I take my Viagra and I get really nervous. Remember, it's all about pleasure and fun. That's the whole point of the intimacy and sex with the partner. And there are many, many, many ways to experience sexual pleasure. It doesn't have to be about an erection. Masters and Johnson did pivotal work. We'll probably never have it again because you could never get what they did through an IRB, trust me. Because they paid people to have sex in front of them, and that will never fly today. I mean, the IRB comes after me because they're like, your questions are very sensitive. You have to be careful, and are you... It's difficult, probably never happen again, but the truth is they found out that women orgasm from clitoral stimulation and they no more need a hard penis than the man on the moon to have a climax. In fact, often the penis inhibits their ability to climax because there's so much focus on all the wrong things. So we know that since the 50s and 60s. And then Dr. Masters said, you know when you know you've successfully treated impotence? When a man doesn't panic when he doesn't get an erection, he's cured. Once he stops panicking because he doesn't get an erection, he is cured. That's what Bill Masters said about it. But the truth is, Masters and Johnson did some incredible work that taught us a lot about that we don't need an erection to have a climax. It doesn't have to be that way, and there's many ways to get there. And excitement comes from anticipation, from mystery. What happens? Study after study by Barry McCarthy and all kinds of people has been done that said desire goes, pfft. Why? Because this is what happens sometimes in relationships when desire goes down the drain. This is what we do. I touch here, you do this. Are you good? I'm good. Did you have a climax? I'm done. We're done. And it always goes the same pattern. This is how we have sex. But guess what? The thing that builds desire, a number one key component in desire, research study after study shows, is mystery. Where will it lead today? We're not allowed to have intercourse. It's like we're 16 again and we are not allowed. It's off limits. But what can we do? How far can we get? Where can we go? Where will it go today? And guess what? The way I wanted it yesterday is not the way I want it today. I have the right to change my mind. And people love the mystery. It's super, super important. Intimacy is vitally important. And you'll hear us say that over and over. So after radical prostatectomy, and after radiation and surgery, why do we talk about this? Because, and these are some of the landmark studies that showed, with nerve sparing and everything, that 8 out of 10 men are struggling with erections, 2 years later, and 7 out of 10, 5 years later. This is taking the very strictest criteria and saying, can you get through sex and keep whatever kind of erection you need to get through sex? Can you do that? And if you can't, you have erectile dysfunction. So with the stricter criteria, they're saying 8 out of 10 and 7 out of 10. And this is the truth and the reality of it, but it's scary. Now, remember, this population's older, in their 60s, so about 50% of these guys would have had erectile dysfunction whether they had their prostate out or not. Let's be fair and nest it properly, because research has to be put in the proper perspective. Then we have the robotic prostatectomy, and we spare the nerves, and it's great, and we can see them, we blow it up 10 times. Well, guess what? My practice is every bit as busy as it was before because we still have to dissect the nerves off the prostate. We have to peel them off the back of the prostate. And doing that traumatizes them. They become inflamed and they don't function properly. So the bottom line is there are great benefits, and many, many people around the world do robotic-assisted laparoscopic prostatectomy. You get out of the hospital in some cases quicker. Some of the opens get out fairly quickly as well, but hospital stay is decreased and less blood loss, and incontinence is still an issue, and so is erectile dysfunction. There's still issues. Erectile dysfunction is still a problem, and we don't have any really good study like the one I just showed you. This is a single site study, but it still says about 7 out of 10 men, which fits somewhat with what you learned earlier. But if you go and look at the studies and you see, well, how many men have sexual dysfunction, erectile dysfunction after prostate cancer? What do the studies say? Anybody know? How many? Throw out numbers. 15. Okay, you got it. That's right. What else? 0 to 100%. That's what the studies show. 0 to 100%. I'm not lying to you. That is literally, if you go in the literature, isn't that what it says, Vanessa? 0 to 100%, depending on how you define erectile function. Because some people say, well, if you get any hardness, you're functioning. Then that's functioning. Well, if you use that demarcation, that's very different from, are you hard enough to get through the sex that you're trying to get through? So lots of different things. Again, with radiation, about 65% of surgery patients and 63% of external beam and 57% of seed patients were having trouble having intercourse. So whether you have radiation or surgery, you're going to probably have issues with erectile dysfunction. The majority of men do. Androgen deprivation therapy not only can cause erectile problems, but even more importantly, it can take away desire or drive. So lots of different side effects and issues. So basically, how does it all affect this? Well, a couple different ways. One way is the most common side effect, whether they take your prostate out or they radiate it or you have androgen deprivation, are sexual side effects. These are the most common things. Now, some people get to a place in their life where sex is not a huge priority anymore, and maybe one or the other they've decided not to be so sexual, and that's perfectly fine. If people are content, certainly we are content. If you're happy, we're happy, that's for sure. Because if you're content with the way your life is, that's perfectly fine. And some people have decided to be sexual with non-penetrative sex, and that's great. And I can tell you, I will share a couple stories with you of that sort as well. But the bottom line is, what works for you and your partner? That's going to be really important. Ejaculation doesn't typically happen after the prostate is removed or radiated, and the penis may shrink up into the body. That's not something that was talked about for many years, but men talked about it in my group constantly. And now studies have shown, yes, penile shrinkage is a true phenomenon. It's a small amount when you look at the mean amount that's lost, but everywhere from I don't notice any loss to I really notice a significant loss. It's like I'm uncircumcised. My penis pulled in like the turtle's head, and it's like the skin is hanging over it, literally like I'm not circumcised. So we hear the gamut of things. But it is a true phenomenon that can happen, you usually lose a little less than an inch average. These factors can really impact how a man feels about himself, how his partner feels, how their jargon and their communication occurs. Speaking of communication, Dr. Sizemore.
So communication becomes important in every aspect of intimacy. If you can't communicate with your partner, you're going to be in enormous trouble. So you've got to not only speak with your partner, but you've got to speak with your physician. And when you speak with your physician, there are ways to make it more likely to be effective. It's useful to bring your partner with you. And the reason for that is when people are talking about sex, they tend to be very uncomfortable. We don't have a language of sex, particularly sexual dysfunction. And so you're anxious. Anxious anxiety is a problem for remembering things. And so if you bring your partner, you've got two sets of ears to hear what's being said, to remember to ask the questions, much more likely you'll get a good outcome. So you need to ask what the specific treatment effect of the sexual functioning, when to anticipate change and when to come on back and ask some more questions. Now, when you're doing that, you may have trouble getting all the answers you need. And so it makes sense bringing a list with you and repeating back what the physician said so that you know for sure that you heard what was said accurately. Earlier, someone spoke to the issue of how physicians need to respond to their patients. Some physicians are superb responders and some are not. You need to remember you're the customer. And you deserve to get the responses you need. And so bring a list, ask the questions, make it clear that you need better responses if you're not getting what you want. And if you still don't succeed, find another physician because you deserve to be treated as a customer that you are. So sexual talk is often difficult. And so you have to create a sense of warmth and closeness while you do this talk, which means the tone matters. It needs to be gentle. It needs to be loving. This is not about efficiency. This is about caring and connection. And touching is important. Touching is as important as any of the verbal communication, but you need both kinds. It's important to create a sense of romance in your relationship. And so we need to talk about when and where to talk to each other. If you have to perform, you're going to be more anxious. So it's important to talk outside the bedroom. Talk in the park, talk in the kitchen, talk any place, but talk where the anxiety level will be absolutely reduced. And talk about the obstacles to talking. Self-consciousness caused by all the physical changes. That penis, you know, that got smaller. You need to talk about it because if you're just worried about that smaller penis and how each of you sees it and what the effect of that is, then you're not going to be able to function. So you need to talk about that. You need to talk about weight gain, weight loss, because if you're not feeling comfortable about your body, that'll make a difference. And talking about it, talking about the insecurities also allows you to segue into some of the talk about sex itself. But the insecurities are there. And to deny them and try to go forward with talk about sex just gets in your way. And of course, people are afraid they're not going to be able to perform as well as they used to. Got to talk about that too. They won't be able to perform as well as they used to. Perhaps they'll perform better. They'll perform differently. And that's something that both people have to be aware of and need to be able to laugh about and recognize they're going to screw up in this process, because sex is difficult under new circumstances anyways. And if you can't laugh about it, and if you can't be playing with it, then you're in trouble. So again, talking about the difficulty with performance becomes really important. And then again, people don't talk about sex anyways in everyday life. And now they've got to start talking about it. Well, the more you talk about it, the easier it gets. And it's important to remember that. I guess I hope we'll have a question and answer series here just to begin that conversation. Because without the conversation, you're stuck. You can read as many books as you want, but you have to share it with your partner. Also, if you actually do get stuck, there are a lot of sexual therapists out there. There's a lot of help you can get, so use the help. So before treatment, you need to assess anxiety and depression and any of the other medical situations like high blood pressure, cancer, diabetes, that could get in the way. Anxiety is not an aphrodisiac, as Jeff has already said, nor is depression. And high blood pressure, well, there's some medications for high blood pressure that will be make it certain that there'll be no erections, and the erections may have more to do with the high blood pressure medication than anything else. So again, assessing all of that becomes important. And then we look at all the multiple treatments. Now, I think this is the important thing, the multiple treatments. And when doing multiple treatments, you really need to have both people there, because it's part of the communication process. Sensei's focus. Masters and Johnson originated Sensei's focus, and it's used today. Sensei's focus is done independent of what the sexual dysfunction is, because it is a way of people getting to know their own bodies and communicating that knowledge to their partners. It's nonverbal, and it's a form of massage, but more sensual massage that in the first stages avoids the genitals entirely, because you might find out that your elbow or your shoulder or a part of your leg really likes to be touched and really has a sensual quality you never knew you had. And so, and also, it's a way of partners touching each other and learning how much pressure or how much lightness they like in this touch. And the other important component of all of this is there's no outcome. We're not trying to have an orgasm. We're trying to know our own bodies and communicate them. The concept is giving to get. The important thing is to get, to know your own body and to get what you need. And in order to do that, you learn how to give to your partner, and the partner, your partner learns how to give to you. So once you've learned that, then you can move on to specific therapies for particular sexual dysfunctions. But this is just a delightful thing for partners to do, and it allows for, again, nonverbal communication first, but after you've done the sensate focus, then you can talk about how it felt or what you liked, or again, and you can play with it. Masturbation. Masturbation is a wonderful thing. So many people have given it up for one reason or another, thinking that everything has to be related to each other, or that, gosh, we lost a health provider because she suggested masturbation was a good alternative to sexuality with kids, and she was kicked out of the government. Masturbation is essential because when you masturbate, blood goes to your genitals, And that blood makes for healthy genitals. So the more you masturbate, the more you get that blood to your genitals, the better the shape of your genitals. So whatever's fun, you ought to be doing it, and it's fun. And any of the things that get in the way need to be pushed aside. Erotic fantasy. Orgasms do not happen in the genitals. They happen in the brain. And the more impulses you get to the brain, the easier it is to have orgasm. There, you've all got pamphlets on other course, and when you go outside, you'll find some other pamphlets of sexual fun opportunities. And these pamphlets came from a store in Madison, Wisconsin, owned by a woman physician and a woman social worker. And very bland-looking store, looks like a lawyer's office, and it's a sex toy shop. But it's a sex toy shop where people look at each other and talk. You don't have to look at the floor and pretend you're not really there. But in fact, there are pamphlets, there are 800,000 kinds of vibrators, all of which you could play with, and lubricants, and books, and magazines, all kinds of ways to encourage exploring things you may never have explored before. Because sex can get boring if it's too routine. In fact, even speaking to that, romance was once part of people's relationship. But oftentimes in long-term relationships, people start paying attention to the children and their welfare or the job and what's going on there, and the dregs of time are given to each other. Well, if you wait till 10 o'clock at night, you know, to have sex, there's not going to be much happening, and it's certainly not going to be varied. And it erodes relationships. So it's important to, in the communication, make romantic time, prime time. So I think everyone needs a date night where they go out and they remember romance and they don't talk about anything difficult. They don't talk about the mortgage or the finances or the kids or the work or what's not working physically. But they talk about the movie or the dinner or the flowers or whatever is around and preferably things that they can laugh at and share together, because that's so very important. All of these things are enhanced by erotic fantasy as well. There are X-rated films, there are magazines. I did my dissertation many years ago. I was in graduate school for too long. I was a sociologist first, and then I became a psychologist. And I was getting a little bored, and so I decided I'd study something that would keep me awake. So I did my dissertation on female orgasm and erotic fantasy, and it kept me awake. and I'm very grateful for that, because what I learned is that most people use erotic fantasy. They don't share that because they think there's something wrong with it. And yet, the more erotic fantasy, the easier it is to have orgasms. Now, oftentimes people are afraid of their erotic fantasy because they think if they get into it, it's going to morph into reality. And erotic fantasies tends to be things people don't want to do in reality. And it doesn't morph. For example, the second most erotic fantasy of women is rape. Now, women do not want to be raped in everyday life. They absolutely do not. There's a lot of data on that. It's even intuitive that would be the case. But as erotic fantasy, it works. And the most popular erotic fantasy is making love with someone other than who you're making love with. But do people really want to be with that other person? No. But if it works, then again, it's all these additional stimulations. So Jeff has a whole list of books and movies and such that he passes out to his patients. He probably could provide you with those lists. I encourage people to get into this erotic fantasy because it makes everything easier. Lubricants. There are all kinds of different lubricants, and different people respond differently to different ones. The lubricants help when there's pain with penetration. And so it's important to find out what you like and to use them. New positions. Oftentimes when you've had sexual dysfunction, you need some new positions, one of which is men tend to have an easier time having an erection standing up as opposed to in some of the other positions. Masters and Johnson discovered that 75% of their respondents liked that position the most, worked the best. However, the recommendation is to learn this position, learn it with all your clothes on, because you're going to screw up. It's not so easy. Now, once you get there, it's the most satisfying of all. But doing it with your clothes on for a while allows you to acknowledge that this is fun, this is crazy, we're going to fall down while we're doing it. You know, all of that is really quite important. Vibrators, again, there are so many kinds of vibrators. Even in Walgreens these days, you could get vibrators. And again, it helps both men and women because it gives a much stronger sensation to the penis, to the vagina, whatever. Vaginal dilators, that's a woman's issue, but if a woman's having difficulty being penetrated because her vagina is too narrow, there's a series of vaginal dilators that can be used to expand the vagina very adequately. Pelvic floor physical therapy. Oftentimes the pelvic floor gets weak and you really need a strong pelvic floor to have an adequate orgasm. And so men need to be doing Kegel exercises, and there's some external forms of massage that can help get that pelvic floor stronger. The pelvic floor is really pretty important also for incontinence. So, and there are, you know, all kinds of toys at the sex toy shop that help with that pelvic floor getting stronger. Eros CTD is something which is sort of it's for women who are having difficulty having orgasm. It provides more sensation to the vagina, and if anyone cares to talk about that later, we can, but we'll move on to men's things. So I'll pass the baton to Jeff for a while.
So we have lots of different treatments, and we're happy to answer your questions about any of them, because they all can be complicated. What I find oftentimes, first off, I always talk to patients and I say, you know, I want you to start I have a whole chapter in the book about how the brain is really important with sex, and I have a chapter in the book also on sex without erections. So I was telling this older couple, I said, you know, have you thought about this? Have you worked on some manual stimulation, some oral stimulation, some vibratory? What would you feel comfortable with? And they were in their 70s, and they're like, well, we've never even thought about all that. Nor did we know, I don't even know what the clitoris is. Can you show me what it is? And so I did. And I said, I showed a picture and said, this is what the clitoris is, and these are the things I want you to go home and work on. He had had prostate cancer and had trouble getting erections, and so he was using a vacuum pump, and it was working quite well. But he came back to me, and we'd been working together for a while, but remember, I always have this conversation about outer course and how important intimacy is. And so he comes back and he puts the vacuum pump down on the desk in front of me. He says, my wife says to give you that. And I'm like, well, patients always come with their partner, almost always to my clinic. So I'm like, where is she, by the way? And he's like, she didn't come. And I said, what happened? And he said, well, she said, we don't need that anymore. This was a gentleman who said, gosh, after prostate cancer, and this happens, in our study we had a few people who had this, it's a small percentage, but he said, my climax is more intense than it's ever been before. So now we're doing all these things without erections, and I'm having better climaxes than I've ever had in my life, which is not super common, but it does happen sometimes, and we actually had two men in our study who reported that as well, so a small percentage. And then he said, and my wife, now that we're paying attention to the clitoris, she said she's had the best climaxes of her entire life, so we don't want the vacuum anymore because we don't need erections. I said, okay, that's fine. So he says, is that okay? I said, of course that's okay. Are you happy? Yes. He said, I'm telling you, we're having the best sex of our lives. This is a great day in my clinic. I'm just telling you. It's like, this is the best part of my job, is I'm like, wow, here's this couple in their 70s who are telling me their intimacy and sex is better than it's ever been their whole life. So it can be very important. When we add in all these things, and already, just like Dr. Sizemore said, I'm dating myself, but do you remember the commercial? I can bring home the bacon, fry it up in a pan, right? And it's like, I can do all the work, I can do everything, and then come home and take care of love. But by 10 o'clock, it's like my wife says, the minute you hit the pillow, you are gone, and it is over. You are sleeping. That's it. Because we're exhausted. Our lives are full of many things, and we don't always make romance and intimacy a priority. Now we add in a pill. But you have to time the pill. When are you going to take it? Because remember, you got to take it on a fairly empty stomach. Even though a lot of them say you can take it with food, ideally you got to take it on an empty stomach. And then it's going to start kicking in 30 to 60 minutes, but it's probably going to take 90 to 120 minutes to give you the full effect. So my wife and I go for a romantic dinner. What do you think, Dr. Alba? What should we do? When should I take my pill? Well, I said, you're taking Cialis, so let's take it before dinner, about an hour before. Then by the time you go to dinner, and afterwards we go dancing, and then we come home and we want to have sex. I said, by the time you get there, you will definitely be ready. But how do you navigate your way through that? That's what we try to do in the clinic. Not just hand you a prescription, but go, what are you going to do with this, and how's it going to work? I have guys who come in and say, I'm going to surprise my wife. We haven't had sex in 11 years, and I'm going to do these injections, and... Not on my watch, you're not going to do that. I can tell you for sure. That is, first off, your wife needs to be here with you. Where is she? Let's talk to her and see how she feels about it, because you haven't had sex for 11 years, and we got to look at the whole picture. So all these things have issues. So we have lots of different things. We have intraurethral suppositories, which look like this. After you urinate, you slide it down the hole. You push the button to drop the drug inside. And so how are we going to work this into love play? That's going to be kind of interesting. Or we're going to give ourselves a shot in the penis. Anybody want to line up and show us how that's done? Come on, I need a volunteer. Come on. Okay, right? But so we got to get over a lot of hurdles to deal with these. And then how are we going to incorporate that into our love play with our partner? And men are freaked out about it. But then when we did a study, that because men kept telling us it doesn't hurt, we said, don't be afraid of the pain. But there are other things that may make you not want to do this. It's far from perfect. There's good, bad, and ugly with every treatment option. Just because your neighbor or your friend at the support group said, this will change your life, it's the greatest thing in the world, maybe it's not right for you. Because you have to figure out how you're going to put this together and give it to yourself. And are you comfortable with that? If you're afraid of needles and you tell me, if you hold a gun to my head, I'm not sticking a needle in my penis, this is not the treatment for you, okay? And I'm not going to tell you that this is the right treatment for many men. It's the right treatment for some men. And do I have patients, like one of my patients who sat in my office and literally, he and his wife, I always have tissue in my office. And the woman that I'm training to do the same work that I do now in my clinic said, it's really good you have that tissue there, because people cry a lot in my office. After he came to me and he said, gosh, I can't get erections. I haven't had erections for 5 years. And I'm like, wow, you had your prostate out though like 2 years ago. So what's going on? He's like, well, I had problems before then. So he shares with me, actually said, you know, Dr. Alba, it's kind of complicated. And I said to his wife, tell me a little bit about it. What's happening? Why has there been problems for 5 years? And she says, well, 5 years ago, it was a very, very hard year in our lives. And I said, if you don't mind my asking, what happened? And I think my patients are the bravest people in the world, because they already got to share stuff that nobody wants to share with anybody, so I can help them. And she said, 5 years ago, our oldest son was killed in a car accident. Wow, I said, I am so sorry. I mean, what do you say? What could be worse than losing a child? She said, that's not all. 2 weeks later, our other son killed himself because of that. So she said, we have struggled with intimacy. He is broken. This man's broken. I love this man, but he's broken. I don't care about his erections. His erections aren't broken. He is a sex god to me. I don't care about that. But he's broken. His spirit's broken. He's broken, and he's been broken for 5 years, and we need each other desperately. Can you help us? We did injections. When I walked back in the room and pulled the curtain back, both of them, tears streaming down their face. He picks me up, and he hugs me. He's got an erection. He picks me up, and he hugs me like this. He says, Dr. Alba, I love you. I'm just like, all right, all right. He goes, do you know what you've done for me? I'm like, I have a pretty good idea because you're hugging me. Okay, some things are not meant to be shared, but bottom line is we know, don't we, Vanessa, that sometimes for the right man, this could change your life. For another man, it could be the worst thing in the world. Who are you? That's my job, to help you figure out who are you and are you ready and should you do it? Because not everybody should. So we say, well, you're a non-invasive kind of person, so let's do the vacuum pump. But you're single and you walk in with this and say, hi, honey, let's go, right? So how are we going to deal with that? Or you've got a partner. How are we going to do it? What are we going to do with it? That's my job, is to help you figure that out, is what are we going to do to incorporate it? Not just to write you a prescription, which I do all the time, but to help you figure out, how do I make that work in my love play with my partner? How do I make it work? And why have we not had sex for 11 years? Because there's a myriad of reasons, and we got to get to the bottom of it. And that's why we use therapists, and we work. We have to deal with the relationship. They sent me for all kinds of couple training at the VA, because the truth is, I have to deal with couples. I have to deal with the relationships, because intimacy is about a relationship. It's about a relationship. So it's complicated, and I can speak to all these things in great detail, but I'm going to leave it up to you how much you want to talk about that or not, because we're ticking the time, because we started about 10 minutes late, because I know you were having such a good time out there, and we didn't want to drag you in, but we will stay afterwards, too, to answer your questions.
I wanted to make reference to this erection tension ring that you call it, otherwise known as a cock ring. And
so you can see.
It works wonderfully, and it has...
There.
And those. There. And it allows a man's penis to stay rigid after he's had an erection. It makes it more difficult for the blood flow to return quickly, and so that would be the point of a man using it. But you notice on the further picture, there are little bumps on that cock rig, or those cock rigs. Well, what those bumps do is, during penetration, they knock against the woman's clitoris, which makes it much more likely that she would have an orgasm. In addition, the culture has changed enough that you can go to Walgreens and buy one of these, which has a vibrator in it as well. And so, in the context of penetration, you're both vibrating yourself and vibrating the woman's clitoris. And because you can get it at Walgreens, that's the evidence the culture has changed, and sharing that information with clients makes it so much easier for them to accept these kind of notions.
So it can be really helpful. So here's a form of tension loop. This one slips over the hard penis. Now this is for a man who gets hard but can't stay hard. And then you pull on the ring without the ball. The ball catches in that ring and it helps hold you hard while you're having sex. But there's all kinds of different things. And since the dawn of man, on cave walls, there are pictures of these things. So they've been around forever. Trust me. Trust me, there really are. And the bottom line is, these can help sustain an erection. But if you don't get hard enough to start with, then we have to really work on, how are you going to use this? And if you practice with it every day and you become, I tell people all the time, you're going to be the master of the pump master for sure. And it's going to take a lot of practice and work because it's very mechanical. If you go to do your VCR and you skip a step or you do a step backwards, is it going to work? No. And neither will this. It's very mechanical, and you have to learn how to get around it. But if you incorporate it, I had a patient this week who said, I'm coming to your talk, to us too, me and my wife, because I don't understand why these men are so resistant to this. I'm going to go tell them about it and how successful we've been. He is not getting his erections just yet hard enough without it. But with it, from the beginning, he's like, I've been able to have penetrative sex. We've had so much fun. It's been so great. But is this right for everybody? No way. Do many of these sit up on a shelf and collect dust? Absolutely. So this is not right for everybody, but it is non-invasive and it does work in 80 to 90% of patients. But the resulting erection does not feel as normal. So for this patient, and he's a young guy, very happy with it. In fact, I said, you have to start working on your penile rehab. He's like, but it's going so good. I'm like, you still have to work on getting your erections back. He's like, but this is all going really good. I said, that's great, but we still have to work on getting your erections back, because I'm hoping you won't need that for the rest of your life. You're in your 50s. But the bottom line is, some people hate it. Everybody's different. Who are you? How can we help you move forward? Yes. So we could do like a 3-hour lecture on it, but I can brush on it. So what I would say is, testosterone historically is nothing that has ever been was ever given to prostate cancer patients, because prostate cancer is a testosterone or androgen dependent, in most cases, It's an androgen-dependent cancer, just like breast cancer can be estrogen-dependent. So in the past, it was a strict contraindication that you could not take testosterone if you had a history of prostate cancer. But more and more, they're using testosterone in patients with prostate cancer safely, mostly because of the work of Dr. Monahue up in Morgan Teller on the East Coast, who was a pioneer who said, this doesn't make sense. It's complicated, but let me try to quickly explain to you. Think about you're watering a plant, but the plant only takes so much water and then the water washes by it, right? Your androgen receptors, especially the ones for sex, are like that plant. So if you have a testosterone that is above a very low threshold of like 150-ish, okay, then your plant is saturated and we can pour it on all we want and it's not going to make that much of a difference in the prostate and prostate cancer. That's the saturation theory. So why then is it that if we take testosterone away with androgen deprivation that we can control prostate cancer? Not cure it, but control it. Because we drop it below the saturation level and now the plant, what will it do? Wither away and go away, right? That can be the demise of the plant, or it may rebound back. That's how it works, okay? So the bottom line is that's how it works. So if you have a threshold and you have an abnormal testosterone and symptoms of low testosterone, the bottom line is that you will, when you take testosterone, they think it can be safe in some men who especially have had their prostate removed or radiated and they no longer have prostate cancer. They also even use it in some men who have active cancer because of that saturation theory, and that emerging research says it may be safe. It's still a very tricky wicket, but that's the reason why, and it's a long, complicated thing, but I can explain more, but we're running out of time because we started like way late, and so now we're running out of time with things again. But bottom line is, I think that it can be really important. We were going to talk to you a bit about relationships, how important managing conflict and building a friendship and things like that can be, and how important positivity in your relationship can be. But we don't have time for that, so I'm going to scooch through it super fast. We also were going to talk just a little bit about penile rehab, but I will be out in the hall if you have questions and I can stay and answer them. Unfortunately, I will be back to the gala and I'll be happy to answer your questions then, but I had a very dear friend that died and I have to go to a wake. And then come back for the gala event and a memorial tomorrow morning.
Will be here, however. And so people
yes,
have
so
questions.
We'll be here in the hall for a while, and then after I'm here in the hall for a little while, the other thing is I will be back for the gala, so if you have questions. We did give you all a book. We gave you also a handout with 50 Shades of Love. I think you'll find it some of those things really fun and exciting to think about. But in conclusion, what I'd like to say is that sexual dysfunction is common, whether we like it or not. This is something that often comes with treatment of prostate cancer because the prostate is part of the reproductive sexual system of a man. So if we take it out or we radiate it, you're probably going to have sexual side effects. It's not going to be the same. I don't care what anybody tells you, because climax changes, things are different. And you need to understand that before you go under the knife or before you have radiation and throughout the whole process, so we can work on penile rehab, which in the most simple sense is regular masturbation for blood flow. But you can also do things to enhance it. There's more to sex than intercourse if you haven't gotten anything out of it. There's more to sex than intercourse. There's a lot of ways to be intimate, and you don't have to have an erection to do that. And communication is really a key to success with really enjoying sex together. There's multiple treatments, but there's no right one for everybody. They all have good, bad, and ugly. The empowered patient understands the good, bad, and ugly of each treatment and makes choices based on those treatments of what's right for them and their partner. There's only two opinions that matter in my office: your opinion and your partner's opinion. If you have other partners, their opinions matter too, but beyond that, nobody's opinion matters. Expert help is available, and you can get treatment, but you've got to reach out for that help. My patients are the bravest patients in the world because they come in and tell me all these really scary things. That guy, though, I got him on the way out. You know, he said to me, well, Dr. Alba, we use a lot of humor. Only, because like Dr. Sizemore said, we have to laugh at ourselves. But the bottom line is, on his way out, that guy says, I'm at the computer, at the printer out in the front, and he says, Dr. Alba, do you know how good you are at your job? I haven't had an erection like that since I was 18. And everybody in the waiting room is looking at me like, One more quote about support, and I want to end on this, and this is what one of the patients in one of the support groups said from our study. He said, I come in here shaking like a leaf, man. I get in here with a bunch of guys that had been where I was and about to go, and man, they get me gassed up with that strength. And like I said, when I came in here, I was shaking like a leaf, but when I left, I was empowered. That's what one of you said about the Us Two group. That's what you said it did. So make no mistake, support and advocacy is critical. And the work that Us Two does is phenomenal. And I'm privileged to have taken up your time today to share some of my expertise with you. It's an honor and a privilege to work with all of you and to share your journey. So thank you so much.